One of the great things about Folium Book Studio is that you also get the Folium Cover Designer included free with each project. Folium Cover Designer is the way that we can create beautiful cover art really, really quickly, even if you're not an artist. So for example, I'm not a graphic designer, and I'm going to show you how I made this piece of cover art in just a few minutes. Currently, I am inside my cover art designer. I've gone into my project, and you can see up here on my toolbar that I'm in the cover tool. And this is what it looks like. Over here on the left, I have a variety of layers, and then I also have a background. Looking through the layers, I can simply scroll through. I've given names to certain ones, and others are labeled based upon how they're called out in my gallery, and I'll show you that in just a few moments. The background and the layers act like accordion tabs, so when I click one, then it brings its contents into view. Let's go ahead and do something pretty radical. I've got my background here, but I'm going to get rid of everything and show you how it works. So I'm going to delete, and I'm going to delete, and I'll keep on deleting all of these layers. Now, you might be saying, hey, John, you're crazy for doing this. And perhaps I am, but look at what I can do here. I have an undo button up here, as well as an undo all. If I were to click undo, then it's going to undo my last action. Undo again, and undoes the action before that. So it's really easy for me to go ahead and feel free to do something wild and crazy, like getting rid of all my layers. Now let's take a look at our background. Notice here, and I'll pop into the preview, that we seem to have a gray background with a white border. Well, notice what we have over here in our background. It says background color is gray and that we have a border. I'm going to click the widget and play with it, and you'll notice that it instantly changes in the piece of cover art. So apparently, I wanted to have this border and I wanted to have this background before, so we'll leave it and see what it does. I'm going to click into the layers, and of course it's completely empty because I just deleted everything. So let's go ahead and add in something. It's kind of smart to work from back to front with layers, and quite honestly, I don't remember the exact order of these, and so we'll play around. Now, I just clicked to insert an image layer. You saw that, and notice that it instantly brought up my gallery. Well, my gallery, all the way at the left, tells me that I started at home at some point, and it's taken me into my images and into this project, which is called Private Days, and into the cover chapter. Now, the cover is treated as a separate entity in a project, but I could have other artwork in other chapters, and they would all show up here in a list. But since I only have images and cover art, that's why it's showing here. I'm going to go ahead and insert this image. I just click the green insert. Now, of course, it's not filling up the entire area, and that could be a little bit problematic, so how do we deal with that? Well, I like to get in the habit of just clicking on the layer that I want to work on, and then I come over here to my layer controls, and notice that I have everything from changing what the image is on the layer to image type. Oh, well, there's single and tile. Let's see what happens if I tile this. Notice that it broke it into a repeating pattern. That's kind of cool. I also have size controls. Well, this is going to be particularly handy for me for what I need to do. So I'll resize it till I think it's just the right size there. I won't add a border here. And so let's see, shadow. I don't need a shadow on it. I'm not going to rotate it, but if I wanted to, I could just rotate it around. That's kind of fun. Might have some use for that at some point. Of course, opacity can definitely come in handy when you're putting layers together. That way one thing can be seen behind another. But notice that there's something else here. I've got blending down here. I'm going to try blending screen. Oh, that's interesting, and blending multiply. Well, I think we're going to have to do a different video on the options with opacity, blending, screening, multiply, things like that. But you can get the sense that I have the ability to take one layer and change how it's affecting the layers below it. Let's put that back to normal. Now, what's this gap down here? Because everything looked like it was fitting up here, let's pop into preview. Well, I see that there's a gap at the bottom. Where's that from? Well, it just is saying that I need to move this down. So I'll click it, drag it, and let's look at the top. There's still a gap there. So this says that essentially I need to resize things. So let's go ahead and scale that up. And notice down here we have the ability to center the image both horizontally as well as vertically. When I do that, now I'm getting complete coverage of my area, which is exactly what I want. So let's go on to the next layer. Again, I'm going to click that plus sign and say that I want to insert an image layer. It's going to bring up the gallery and it's put me back into the cover collection for my current project. Let's select this one. This kind of wispy, cloudy sort of thing. If I wanted to see it close up, I could click on the magnifying glass on the image. And look at this. Notice that I can actually see through to what's behind there. Well, this is telling me that this particular image has some transparency going on there, which is absolutely perfect. It's what I want. Notice that I see the same thing here. So I click the image because I like to do that just to make sure I've selected it. If you want to see what happens when I click outside of it on the gradients, on the orange gradients, notice that it brought the gradients into focus. I click on this and it brings these wispy dark things into focus. I'm going to have the same need to scale up, and let's just check the preview. Well, we've got that gap there. So let's center it vertically and now scale up a bit more, and I bet it's absolutely perfect. It is. Look at that. If I wanted to change where this heaviness is here, perhaps because of where I'm going to put some text or whatnot, I could rotate. So let's go ahead and rotate it 180 degrees. Now I've got that darkness down here, and perhaps that's where I want to put something else, some text, some the by the author or something like that. That's all fine. If I find that these dark areas are too dark, then I can just reduce the opacity like this. Now I've got kind of a nice effect going on there. Let's add another layer. You know it's going to be an image layer. It's going to bring us into our gallery. It's in our project, in the cover art. And what about this one here? Well, let's use the magnifying glass and take a look at it. And again, we have this transparency, this semi-transparency going on. So we can see that this is going to be used for shading, which should be nice. It will add some extra darkness for us. But let's move its opacity down a bit. And we'll want to go ahead and position it, scale it up. So now we've added some kind of overall darkness going on here. And if we wanted to boost that effect, we could do that. But you know what? Let's have fun with this one. Let's scale it down a bit and let's rotate it and put it at a bit of a jaunty angle. Something like that, I think. And this will give us a little bit of dimensionality and a bit of focus towards the center of things. It's just going to be for fun. Now let's add, another copy of this. I duplicated it right there, and I'm going to change its rotation so that I get another angle. And when I preview, so you can see that I've just created an effect out of nothing, essentially, just a couple of layers that I've grabbed. And finally, let's add in our last image layer, and it's going to be this. Well, what is this? Let's take a look at it. Well, it's just this ribbon that's been brought in. And I'm going to show you where all of these initial images come from. They come from the stock art, which is part of Folium Book Studio and part of the gallery. So I've got this. Obviously it's too small, so I need to scale it up. And I also want it at an angle because I'm going to use it to kind of create a band across which I'm going to put my title. So let's scroll our work surface down and just click and drag this. Probably about there, I think. Let's preview. That's pretty good. So I need to get my book title in here. Click to add a text layer. And look at this. It says that I can insert title, subtitle, or author with just one click. So I'll do that. I click to insert my title. I'm adding the text. And here it is. Well, first of all, it's not the way that I want it to look, and it's certainly not in the right place. So let's get the positioning down a little bit first. I clicked it, that selected it, I dragged it down. It's got a shadow on it, and I don't want that shadow. It's actually more of a glow since it's white. And I'm going to need to rotate it so that it's the same as my ribbon here. Let's tell it that we want the text to be centered, just so that as we work on resizing it, that text size will be growing from the center. And let's make it about that large. Now, what do we do about color? Well, let's click this gray there, because we can see very clearly that the gray of our text was corresponding with that gray there. And I'm going to click and drag the little color indicator, and I'm going to bring it over about here. Now, notice that this color that was selected just was this is how it happens to be. It was not by design or anything. If I want to shade the part of the color family that's being displayed here, I would simply click and drag these little triangles, and notice that they're moving through the rainbow. And as they do so, the text on the workspace is also changing color in correspondence with where that little circle is. So let's put this back into our kind of pinky roses in there. Great. Well, not quite so great. Let's click on our zigzag ribbon design here, and it's just popping a little bit too much for me. I'm going to get rid of the shadow off of it, and I'm going to try one of these things, this multiply. Well, that's actually kind of cool. It's turned it into more of a red ribbon there, and now our text is popping out a bit. What would happen if we screened? Well, that would make it more pink, but I think we'll go with the multiply effect, which is making it a bit more red. It's picking up some of the color from underneath. And clicking on our text scrolls that text back into view. Now we can work on our font. So if we wanted a different font, we would just click and find one. We've got them broken into different categories in here. Modern, heavy, light, handwriting, humorous, mid-century, classics, things like that. I'm going to try a modern one here. That's a little bit too modern for me. Let's try this one. Well, that's kind of nice. It doesn't fit any longer, however, so I simply need to grab the widget, slide it down until it fits. So what else can we do with this? Well, let's try to expand it a little bit by putting a border on it. That white border is kind of nice, but I'm finding that I really don't like the pink going on with the oranges. So I'm going to change the color here. Let's grab those triangles and bring it down into a different part of the rainbow. And perhaps this sort of an orange, a pumpkin, is going to work nicely there. If we wanted to pump it up a little bit more, we could add some shadowing. Well, my shadow color is actually set to be lighter right now. It's set to be white. So what would happen if I set it to be black? Oops, I overreached there. Notice what happens when you do that. Everything on your page selects, and that's because this really is a web page that has this extra app functionality. But with my shadowing there, I get kind of an interesting text effect. And that was pretty simple. And of course, I could still play with opacity if I wanted to do that. Let's preview. That's looking kind of nice. I think that would stand out when it's on an ebook shelf. So let's finish it off. Let's add in text for the author. We'll put the author's name in here, and I think it needs to be up here. We'll need to click it. Let's center it horizontally. Let's get rid of our shadowing, and let's put it into the same font as we used for the title there. Need to change the color, so we'll go from that gray. Click our circle. Let's bring it up all the way into the whites. And there we have the author. Let's see what it looks like if it's up here. And we'll center it horizontally again. Perfect. And down here, let's put in, we've got a subtitle on this book. Click it, drag it, think about there. We'll want to put it into the same font. Probably needs to be a bit smaller. It's not quite as important. And let's try getting rid of our shadow. And of course, change our color. Let's center it. Now let's take a look at what we've done. Well, there's a couple things that I probably want to do. And this is where just playing and doing something that fits your own tastes starts to come into play. So balancing out a little bit between the top and the bottom is what my eye is telling me that I need to do right now. Making things a little bit equidistant from the center. And so that's how quickly I can come up with a cover design. Now, I promised to show you where all of these images that we used came from. All of these that are in the cover for Private Days actually came from back here. If I were to go to Home, go into Stock Images with a click, and in here there's a wealth of different images. Let's take a look at overlays. Well, we've got a variety. Grungies, marbled squares, and rays. Let's go into grungies. Well, they don't necessarily pop out and say, here's exactly how you should use me. But when you click on them, sometimes you'll have a little bit of a description that tells you how you might use it. So in this case, some of the underlying image will peek through this layer. And that's because we saw when we went to the full view size that it's got transparency on it. That's kind of nice. Same thing with this one over here. And it's bringing it in from the database, and notice that I can see through over here. Well, let's go back to overlays. Let's look at rays. We have some interesting things here. And again, you can always preview these. And if you want to go through them quickly, just use those arrows on the left and the right. These aren't meant to necessarily be your entire background image. Instead, they're meant to be used with other images that you might bring in. They might have come from an illustrator or somebody you know who's an artist or a designer. Or, as with the case of my book cover, I did use them together to create a multi-layered effect in which then I had kind of a unique look, something that nobody else will have. Unless, of course, they did the exact same thing with the exact same images. So we have an awful lot of things in here in terms of the stock images where we encourage you to take a look and to play around. Here's one of the ones that I used for the book. You'll recognize the dark and how it's a rectangle that's in there. Now over here it says copy. What is that for? Well, let's click it. Now I could add this to any of my projects. I'm going to add it to, I'm going to add it to The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. And it says, where do you want to add it? Well, I don't know. Let's add it to the notice. And I'll say copy here. Now it's popped me from my images into Huckleberry Finn into the chapter that's called Notice. And it's put that image there. It's not actually being used in the chapter, but it's put it there so that I can find it later because I thought to myself, I might want to use this in that chapter. I'm going to go ahead and delete it, and it's only going to remove it from the current location. It's not going to delete it from the stock images. I'll always be able to go back there and find it again. There it is. So that's how I got the images into my cover art. Do I like this? Well, I might not. Or I might. If I don't, I can always say undo. Notice that it's going to undo 91 steps. And let's see what happens when I do that. I'll click undo. I click undo. Let's undo all. And it says, do you really want to undo all? And I say, yes, I do. And now it's put us back to the original cover art that I had. That's how easy it is to get in and start playing with the Folium Cover Designer and to create your own special cover art for your project. I encourage you to use the stock images that are part of the gallery and to view the other videos that we have on the subject.